Hello, folks, and welcome to the show, Your Real Estate Today. Today, I've got a great guest with me for the show. His name is Preston Sandlin with Home Inspection Carolina. Hey, Preston, look forward to spending time with you. Yeah, it's going to be fun today.
Absolutely.
We're going to talk about a lot of things. Preston's got a home preventative maintenance checklist he's going to go over today. Got it right here. It's going to be awesome. We're going to talk about it because it is the season. Right, Preston?
It is. Definitely is.
And we're going to talk about a little weirdness, too.
Yeah, a lot of that going around today. Now.
That's right. We look forward to spending time with you, Preston, and to you out there, the show, Your Real Estate Today. We're glad you're joining us this week and every week. You can always listen to us on WBT, 1110 AM, 99.3 FM. Go to the shows tab for a podcast anytime on WBT's website, or hey, just join us on the Jameson Realty YouTube channel, or certainly Home Inspection Carolina broadcasts this show as well. So enjoy the show. And we look forward to more time together talking about your home. Take care. Hello and welcome to the show, Your Real Estate Today. Happy Saturday, I hope, wherever you are enjoying yourself, you're enjoying the day, and you're ready to sit back and relax and enjoy a show that is about your home. I'm Paul Jameson, your host with the Jameson family of companies. That's Realty, Property Management, and Property Investments. Looking forward to spending Saturday with you talking about many, many subjects that relate to your home, its care, things to be looking out for, what I've learned this week. And this week is the week that we talk about the speeding train. Now, I'm not talking about Mecklenburg County's speeding train. I'm talking about the speeding train of the real estate market that we are facing today. So today I'm going to answer the question for you, is the speeding train in the real estate market going to come to a screeching halt? I get asked this
question. I want to know.
Five times a day. Don't you, Preston?
I do want to know.
I tell you, we get asked this a lot, and today you're going to get my answer. And, you know, there's some facts and things behind it. So I look forward to sharing that with you as well. So Preston Sandlin with Home Inspection Carolina is my guest today. Hey, Preston, welcome back.
Hey, Paul, glad to be here. Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, so glad that you're with me again, friend. And it was fun to be featured on your show, which is featured live on YouTube as well. What is the name of your show and when do you air it? I know the answer, but I want you to say.
It's successful real estate broker. It's the successfulrealestatebroker.com. And I do one a month, typically towards the end of the month. But yes, mm-hmm. Paul is on there. One of the best shows I have yeah. so far, and probably will be throughout.
Yeah, he does. Awesome. He does it great. It's a Facebook live show, and really, again, gets a good diverse view from different real estate agents about what's going on in the marketplace, what we see. He even features some listings on there, which is always fun. And it's really been a good show. And I applaud you, Preston, because you keep a pulse, not just on your clients, but you in the market as an investor, as a company, but you also educate a lot of people on what's going on. So kudos to you for that.
You know, I thought you were talking about the podcast you're on. Now I realize you're talking about we do listing and lattes every yes. Friday, the listings mm-hmm. that have, and you were on there. And you were, I apologize. Yeah, every Friday on Facebook Live.
He has so many shows, he can't keep them straight. I'm
media mogul.
That's it. Media mogul, TJ says. Yeah. And so on the way in here, TJ came back to be my producer again this week. And I'm just like, I need my audience to send him a note to not let him leave being producer. The other guy did a great job, but
not TJ.
He ain't TJ. $20s in your encouragement. $20 bills.
Yeah. Also, just FYI and for fun, you know, TJ's got his own gig going too, and I am a huge listener. He and Garrison on Tuesdays and Thursdays do a show about food. TJ, that is a blast.
Oh, listen to this. It's good.
Have you heard it?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
so yeah, it is. TJ is a foodie.
Bad and ugly.
TJ is a foodie. We all have side bets about how many times he eats barbecue during the week. But the, you know, he does a great show. He goes out into the marketplace and tries different places.
Yeah, I know. It's great. I'm afraid to listen to though, because they tell us like the really good ones and also the ones that their scores aren't so good.
Yeah.
And I'm afraid he's like going to ruin one of my favorites.
Mark has ruined several restaurants for me.
Yeah. There's one that's my favorite, but I'm not going to talk about it on the air.
Yeah, me too. Matthews. I'm like, I don't even want to know their score.
It's a funny show. And, you know, when you talk about real estate, and one of the reasons I love to watch it is one of the value propositions in a piece of real estate, and then we'll get down to business, is where it's located and what it's located close to. The amenities around a piece of real estate today, ooh, that's a catchy name. Around a piece of real estate today also is an emotional trigger that helps give it value. So it's a fun show to watch, and it's listen to. I guess you could watch it if you were out peeking through the window. But it's fun. So don't miss it. Tuesdays and Thursday nights starts about 6, right?
Yep.
On 6 to 7?
Yep.
6 to 7. So don't forget that. All right. Preston. What I learned this week is that the market is just getting weird. So, yes. So why is it getting weird? We all know that there is an inventory shortage, and regardless of what I'm about to say, it still is tremendously short in homes. But last Thursday and last Friday, 600 homes went on the market in 2 days. In 2 days, 600 homes went on the market, and people are still in a frenzy. That's nowhere near enough to satisfy the itch that this market has right now. But it was kind of a shock to the system. The system kind of went, and people got a little bit sensitized. I found showings were down, open houses were down. I don't think they knew quite what to do. But people are still seeing fewer options. And the market conditions are slowing people down right now. But here's what I'm also seeing. I'm seeing that sellers are having competition fatigue. And I also see buyers having the real competition fatigue. And when sellers have it, it's more against what they're hearing in the news, and they're saying, gosh, I'm just so tired of hearing about it. And they put these silly numbers out there, not really thinking about what a house should be selling for, and they're getting hit with appraisals that don't match their aspirations. But I also see buyers having competition fatigue going, you know what? I'm just whipped. I've written 5 offers. I haven't won one of them. I'm just done. And they're just going to sit and wait it out. Well, a part of the problem is their agents don't understand this market, and they don't understand how to win. We do at Jameson, but you have to have an experienced agent that understands the market, you know? And there are concerns over also for sellers, where are they going to go if they sell? You got to have a plan.
I got a question about that, Paul. Mm-hmm. Is it going to get you off your...
No, please answer. Free Willy.
Well, you know, like everything you said, there's so much demand and so little supply. And it occurred to me that that's one of the biggest problems is the seller has nowhere to go after they sell a lot of times. And they're in the same... position.
Right.
So, and you talk about winning an offer and something like that. I want to ask you as an agent, could you do this? As a buyer, could you make an offer and then have like part of your thing is you'll allow them to lease back from, if you didn't have to move right away, lease back the house for up to 6 months at a reasonable rate to give them time. My thinking is, could that potentially be the winning offer, even if it's not the highest, because you've solved the seller's problem? And I'll let you answer.
Yeah, the answer to that is yes. As a matter of fact, we see that occasionally. The challenge is, as long as that buyer's timing matches it. And I think that's, if you want to win, that's one of the strategies to win, is give flexibility to the seller, which is exactly what you're saying. But sometimes they're in a position where they've sold and they're looking for a place and they've thrown everything into the bucket. And where are they going to go for 6 months? And I have answers to those questions, and we work out those plans, like Airbnb, Furnish Finder, put your stuff in storage, go on a cruise, you know, do whatever you need to do in the interim. To allow that flexibility. But we'll talk some more about that. We've got plenty of time. Preston Sandlin, Home Inspection Carolina, myself, Paul Jamison. The show, Your Real Estate Today. So much more to come. We'll be right back. News Talk 1110, 99.3 WBT. Hello, hello. Welcome back to the show, Your Real Estate Today. It's Paul Jamison, your host with the Jamison family of companies. That's Jamison Realty, Jamison Property Management, and Jamison Property Investments. Here with Preston Sandlin with Home Inspection Carolina. Hey, Preston.
Hey, Paul. Glad to be back.
All right. So at the last, at the end of the segment, we talked about the market and how weird it's gotten. But I want to tell you one thing. This is going to just make your head pop. All right. So there is a builder in town. There is a builder in town that has decided that when you write a contract on their home, that whatever price you decide upon is not the price potentially you will pay. They have left the contract open-ended. So if lumber prices or other prices go up, guess what happens to your contract price? It goes up. Open-ended purchase contracts? Really?
Ooh, that's crazy. That's crazy.
Yeah.
And it's binding? Is it binding?
Yes. It's like an escalation clause.
That's crazy. That's crazy.
Yes.
It's my personal opinion.
It's nuts. When you sign that contract, you better understand what you're paying.
And then what if you can't, if it goes up and you can't qualify, like your loan can't?
I think they believe they've got a big enough market that they'll sell it anyway. They'll take your money and sell it to somebody else. Isn't that nuts? Think about that, folks, that the market is actually the gall of a builder to do that. It's amazing. All right, rentals. Huge uptick in occupancy based on what we just talked about, Preston. That's why.
Yeah.
If they can't find a place to go and they just want to sit it out and capitalize on this market right now, the very best thing to do is get you a rental. And if you own a rental, it's amazing. The rental rates are climbing very, very quickly right now, irregardless of the fact it's still cheaper to buy. But you can't buy if you can't get under contract, right? Some people...
Open-ended contract.
Right. Based on the current tax laws, which are subject to change, I'm not a CPA. Please consult your CPA for more information. But I had a good night's sleep last night. Some people, because of the tax advantages of the no capital gains, if you're single up to $250,000 or a married couple up to $500,000. Again, this is subject to change, and please consult your tax consultant for more interpretation and consultation. That in, because those parameters exist for their primary home, they're not selling their primary home right away. Because in the two out of the last, if they've lived in it two out of the last 5 years, that exemption stays in place. Now, if the current law stays in place, that means that they have 3 years to rent that home before that money becomes taxable. If current laws stay in place, I'm giving the disclaimer like 10 times because I don't want people to call me. So sometimes they're just saying, you know what? We're just going to rent this because if prices keep going up, why would we sell it? Because it's going to appreciate. Last year it was about 11%, and the market's already gone up 13% this year. I mean, why wouldn't they? And it's become a passive investment. best, a really good thing to do. And so people are saying, I'll just wait a year. Next thing is millennials who drive the market right now in a big way. They don't have enough cash to compete. So they're now going, you know what? We're just going to keep renting. And there's a bunch of those. And on the opposite side of the millennial, more towards this gray-haired guy's bracket, there's a lack of senior-friendly inventory. Right? So seniors are also renting a big portion of the market. So just keeping that in mind. So last, before we move on, I get a lot of questions right now. The secondary home market, the vacation home market, is off the chain. You want to buy a second home? You want to escape the COVID crazy? You want a place to vacation where you can be in control of your environment? And second home is a good way to do it. Well, here's what's happening. Fractional shares of property are now the thing. If you have a home, instead of selling it to one person, you sell it to 2, 3, 4, 5 people with a policy that says you AKA draw straws, you rotate who gets it when, you have a standard of you're buying X months of the fraction, and you pay this, you pay that, and the maintenance becomes shared between the ownership group. It's like a co-op, but not. Okay, but, and it has a particular set of standards. The house next door to us, when we had our vacation property, was sold to 5 different couples, and they each rotated when they used it, and everyone took turns with certain months, and it was a very clear rotation. Everything was spelled out when they purchased it. It's becoming the way to afford a vacation property and not pay the crazy premiums you might pay elsewhere.
I like it. Yeah, I like it.
Right. Coming up later in the show, though, we're going to move on to Preston here in a minute. I will answer the question, is the speeding train in this market going to come to a screeching halt? And again, that's something I continually get asked. But this is the season now, Preston. I think we're through the cold snap. I think we're done. I think it's time to officially say it is spring. Every spring, you have this list that people can get on your website and download. But let's give them a flavor of some monthly things and some spring things over the next few minutes that they should be doing.
Yeah, sure. And thanks, Paul. Yeah, if you go to homeinspectioncarolina.com, click on resources, we have a list that's preventative maintenance. And yeah, there's a couple of things. It's broke down monthly, every 2 months, 3 months, and then, you know, the seasons. And it's a really good checklist. Monthly, some of the things to check are, you know, the sink tub stoppers, you know, clean out debris, that sort of thing. Another good one, this is a really good one, your garbage disposal. Paul, if you run hot water and baking soda in there, it'll clean out that garbage disposal. That's a good thing.
Really? I never knew you had to do that.
Yeah. And then also put, if you ever like eat oranges or lemons, put the peels down in there and that'll clean it and, you know, get rid of some of the smell that can accumulate down in there.
TJ's taking notes over here.
Well, obviously, too, you know, the HVAC, change your filters monthly. You know, that's a good place to put a little air freshener if you got one, you know, but know all the, and that's one thing we do when we do inspections. We take pictures of all, sometimes you got different size filters. Mm-hmm. So when you go to Lowe's or Home Depot, just buy a box of them. It's a lot cheaper that way.
Yep.
And change those things out monthly. And then every 2 months, you want to change register or check the registers, clean the grills on those HVAC systems, clean the grease on the filter on your hood over your stove. That might be hooked to a...
Is that like that metal thing that's...
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. And if you cook a lot of greasy food like us, mm-hmm. it gets pretty dirty. You can actually run that thing in the dishwasher. But yeah, do that every 2 months. The big thing with preventative maintenance, Paul, is, you know, you always heard that saying, a stitch in time saves nine. You know, just what you're trying to do is prevent a really costly repair by doing little things along the way. But, you know, every 6 months you want to test the battery on your smoke detector. I would say go ahead and replace all of them. Because here's the thing, Paul, they only go dead at 2 a.m. It's like the law.
That is the truth.
And when they go dead, they start chirping.
Yes. And then you can't find which one's chirping because they tease you. They go, oh, let's chirp over here. Oh, no, let's chirp over here.
Yeah. Well, and they're wired together, too. But the battery is a backup in case the fire is electrical, you know. So what will happen is the one that's causing it, then all the other ones go off and you're not sure. And then you got to wait another 3 minutes and it's. Just replace them all and don't do like me and just replace one. And then, you know, 2 weeks later, another one goes off. They're all going to, you know, go sooner or later, but yeah, check those. We had a big thing about where they're required on our website too. That might be interesting reading.
Yeah.
But just a couple other things, you know, obviously every spring, clean your roof surfaces, check those and check those screens. Make sure you don't have any cuts or anything like that. But anyway, you can get this on our website, download it. And, pretty cool.
Yeah, it is cool. Well, we've got more with Preston Sandlin, myself, Paul Jamison, coming up on the show, Your Real Estate Today. Hang with us. We'll be right back. News Talk 1110-993 WBT. Welcome back to the show, Your Real Estate Today. Paul Jamison, your host here with the Jamison family of companies. That's Realty Property Management and Property Investment here with Preston Sandlin, owner of Home Inspection Carolina. Preston's company does our home inspections, and for you, he can come certainly do an inspection on your home, whether you're getting ready to sell or thinking about selling. But also, if you want to have your home inspected so that you can check out the things that may be needed to have happen. A lot of times people don't get in their crawl space. They don't get a thorough check of their home, and when and if they are ready to sell, or if something happens, they could have prevented it by having an expert come and walk through their home and give them a list. You know, yeah, shower pans are a great example. And, you know, we've had situations, Preston, where for years there's been a leak of a toilet, of a shower, of a tub, of a sink. I mean, that has been leaking in your crawl space for years.
Now you're gonna have to retile the tub. Plus the floor's rotten. Yeah, we've seen it. And I was like, golly, if they could have caught this 2 or 3 years ago, they wouldn't have to do all this.
Have you seen your floors cup? Have you seen an odor that's come? Have you noticed some changes in your home? Is there some cracking going on? All things to think about, right, Preston?
Absolutely.
It's not just a temperature change.
No. Yeah, have your house looked at, because things can change over time. I mean, you know, and especially, like you said, if there's a leak going on under there, you can catch it early. I mean, it's so, you know, over time, it's going to wind up costing you a lot.
It is. And the other thing I like, especially in older homes, we'll do what's called a pre-inspection. The pre-inspection before you sell, if your home is older, or, you know, it's your parents' home, or the home has sat vacant for a good period of time and you want to sell, you get in there early and you detect if there are any issues so you can resolve them at your discretion, not at the discretion of the buyer, right?
Yeah, two things. Absolutely. And you can, you know, get it priced out. You know, you can get multiple bids, just like you said. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing, Paul, you know, I'm positive that a house that's been pre-inspected, if you had two houses, is going to go for more or higher, because there's more confidence in the seller not losing their the buyer not losing their due diligence. You know,
that's exactly right.
Once pre-inspected versus not. Now they're given high due diligence.
That's exactly right. You know, Preston, on your list, and then, you know, in the next segment, I promise I'm going to answer what's going to happen. You know, what about this speeding train of real estate? Is it going to come to a screeching halt? I promise I will answer that before the end of the show today. But every spring, you've got a list of things from the roof to plumbing. Tell me kind of what are your top three things, Preston, in this list, up three or four, you know, but kind of if there's one that somebody can really pay attention to that outshines the rest, what would it be?
Well, one of the biggest things, Paul, is underneath, if you've got a deck, clean out from underneath that deck. Don't leave firewood under there or an old pallet from some project or something, because that wood to soil contact is going to attract termites. And if you get termites underneath your deck, it's going to trigger a treatment for the whole house. And if you haven't had your house, it's not like ants or roaches, Paul. It's drill and trench. I mean, it's easy $1,000 or more, not to mention the damage it can do to your house. So that would be my number one thing. Just make sure you don't have any firewood, anything underneath your deck. And that's one of the things we find on inspection. That, you know, if I could have told them 3 years ago,
yeah,
not to put on there.
Yeah.
I have a second simple one, if I got time.
Oh, you
I
got find on inspection. Yep.
Inspections, all that. It's a real simple one, but you know, each one of your hose faucets, Paul, like your bathroom, your kitchen, each one of those faucets where the water comes out, there's a little screen. It's called an aerator, and what happens is over time sediment builds up on that, and especially if you're on a well, but it builds up even on another one, and it causes your water pressure to be lower there. And all it is that screen has gotten clogged up. And they actually screw off, just, you know, what is it, righty-tighty, lefty-loosey. Just unscrew it and just turn it upside down and scrub it with an old toothbrush. You know, I recommend doing that at least once a year with all of your faucets.
Yeah, I use my wife's automatic toothbrush. It seems to do a better job faster. You know, one of those electric toothbrushes, it works really well because it gives it that side to side and circular motion and cleans it faster.
Hopefully she didn't use it after you cleaned the aerator.
Huh? Huh?
I said, I hope she didn't use it to brush her teeth after you had used it to clean the aerator.
I'm intentionally saying this. I can hear you. I'm saying, huh?
Oh,
huh?
Got it. Hey, Paul, do I have time for one more tip?
You do. You got time for two.
Okay. Well, one thing I would recommend everybody do out there is to check and see if you have a leak. You know, we talked about the damage that a leak can do underneath. Mm-hmm. Especially
oh, man.
A small
big
leak.
Time.
One thing you can do is turn everything off in your house, water-wise. Don't flush the toilet. Make sure the clothes and the dishwasher is not running. Go out and find your water meter. It's probably near the street somewhere. Take an old screwdriver and a rag. You're going to need an old screwdriver flathead, the biggest one you got, because you might have to, it's probably grown over a little bit. And pull it up and be careful. Sometimes snakes can be in there. And you'll have to open up. There's a meter there. And you might need to wipe it off. See if that meter's running. And if you got your significant other or kid or something inside, you know, you can call them and turn. If they turn on something, that meter will start running quickly. I mean, even on the tents, doesn't take much. But if that thing is moving and nothing is on, you've got a leak somewhere. And you need to get somebody out there to check it out and see if they can figure out where it is. Because one, it's costing you money, you know, if you're getting charged for the water. And two, it could be causing damage where it's leaking. So you need to figure out if you A, got a leak and B, where it is.
Yeah, usually it's the toilet, isn't it?
Sometimes, yeah. Well, what happens, that flapper, yeah, the toilet, you got to replace those every year. That flapper doesn't completely seal, so the water's just running down the drain, so then it's just filling back up trying to catch up, and it just can't. Yeah, that happens a lot. I
see it a lot. Most of the time when I'm in houses and they've been empty for a long time and they don't shut the water off, you can hear those toilets running, and I just reach down and shut them off, the water at the toilet, because I feel bad for people that are paying a water bill on an empty house.
I just shut one down on my daughter's, who's in college, better. Same exact thing. I got to go get a flapper this week.
Yeah,
like
that's
today,
right.
Yesterday.
Yeah. The other interesting thing that people don't pay any attention to is caulking.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, the thing about caulking, Paul, is, you know, everything expands and contracts with the weather, right? When it's cold, contracts.
Yeah.
When it's warm, expands, especially building material, brick, wood. So that's why you have caulk wherever there are seams, where two different types of materials meet, i.e. windows, doors, things like that. And there is elasticity in caulk, but only for so long. After 2 or 3 years, that caulk will get brittle and it'll break. And when that happens, when those things expand and contract, it creates a gap. And then moisture gets in behind the wood or behind the brick where it's not made to handle it, wicks it up and causes damage. So yeah, you got to stay on top of your caulk. I recommend checking it every year. Probably have to replace it every 3-5 years. And when it comes to caulk, get the best caulk you can get because it's a very labor intensive thing. So you won't caulk that lasts longer. So you don't have to do it again as often.
What do you recommend?
Silicone. If you can use silicone, you know, latex, and you know, just make sure it's rated outdoor if you're using, you know, outdoor, because there is outdoor indoor caulk. Just, you know, read the reviews. There's a whole bunch of different type, but you know, there's certain things on life, you know, you can you know, save some money on, but the quality of the caulk isn't something I would try to say. It's like painting. You know this with painting. Don't ever use cheap paint. Because it's the labor of the paint that's so extensive. So anything that's very labor intensive, get the best material you can get.
If somebody wants to do and have you come out and look at their home, do a pre-inspection or have you come by, how do they get you?
Homeinspectioncarolina.com is the best place. If you're on your phone or you know device, you can call us at 704-542-6575. And obviously on that website, I said you can email us from there.
Homeinspectioncarolina.com or 704-542-6575, right?
Yep, that's it.
Home Inspection Carolina. More with the Show Your Real Estate today. We're going to talk about that speeding train and much more when we come back on News Talk 1110-993 WBT. Don't go anywhere. Hello, welcome back. It's Paul Jamison, your host of the Show Your Real Estate today with the Jamison family of real estate companies. That's Realty Property Management and Property Investment here with Preston Sandlin with Home Inspection Carolina. We're talking about your home. Preston kind of gave us some good tips, but the full list of home preventative maintenance lists can be found on the homeinspectioncarolina.com website. So Preston, they want to make sure they download that. There's some great tips here.
Oh, absolutely. And there's a whole lot of other cool lists on there for all kinds of seasonal maintenance and just cool stuff. There's a bunch of videos on there too.
Yeah. So browse his site. Take a little bit of time and you can find some great things to do that will help preserve your home and its value. All right. As promised, is the speeding train in this market going to come to an screeching halt? So today I read an article from Inman, which kind of spurred this, where they interviewed multiple economists. Now, I think you all have figured out my view on economists, which is the only reason they have them is to make weathermen look good. But here is what they said, and then I'll tell you what I think, all right? They said that this year they expect 10% of homeowners that they interviewed, they said that 10% of them stated that they were going to sell. So that's a lot of people thinking that it's time to move around a little bit. Rates, they said, although ticking up a little bit, are expected to stay below 5% even through the year 2024. And as the pandemic begins to unwind, more people will use their discretionary cash in other ways, not buying real estate. And so a lot of that cash will not get absorbed into the housing market. And they said inventories levels are easy for me to say. Inventory levels are expected to rise in the second half of this year, as my first comment suggests, and builders will get to breathe just a little bit easier because they'll start to catch up. All right. So they're saying there will be more houses to sell and that the market will potentially begin to cool off a little bit towards the second half of this year.
I can believe that.
All right. So what I feel like is it's still not enough to stop the train, but it's enough to slow it down. the demand and a growing amount of millennials are trying to buy will still keep the demand up. Seniors are also on the move. That's not in my notes. That's just the truth. And they also want to move, and many want to rent, but there's still a percentage of the population like me that aren't quite ready to rent permanently and still want to own. Later this year, about 3 to 4 months from now, the prices, as I mentioned before, will still increase, but it should slow down, but again, will not stop. So here's my opinion. I expect another factor to hit the market that the economists and the mortgage people and the money people have not talked about. And I spoke about it earlier in my introductory comments. I expect market fatigue to have a big part of what happens in the market ahead. I think rentals will continue to spike as a great alternative, and that if we look at the big hedge funds right now, in order to solve their inventory problem of having, and this is real estate hedge funds that have houses for rent, they're actually building their own inventory now. And realize that is a great way to control their world. So they're building homes, all right? And they're doing it with their own money. So what can happen to those homes? Why? Eventually they can be a rent-to-own type scenario or a lease with a purchase option on it. I just feel as though the buyers are going to get at some point sensitized and say, you know what? I'm just tired of this. And they're going to slow down. And I think with the increases in inventory as it comes through the rest of this year, if that 1 in 10 scenario is correct, I think you're going to see a significant slowdown in the market. But driven as much by fatigue as anything else in the buyer's hands. All right. Investment property, I think, is going to keep on rocking. If you get into an emerging area, like where we're helping our investors.
Help me. And yeah. Boy, has it gone up.
And I think if you're patient, the gems are there. There's something that I go by, which is called the side door principle. The side door principle says, if you want to go through the front door, you better grease your butt. Because you're going to go through with 13,000 other real estate agents to try to find inventory. That's not my way. Sometimes we have to go through the front door, but you got to know how much grease to put on to pass up everybody else. The idea, don't you go in the gutter with me, Preston. The idea is, I said with me, did you notice? The idea is to go in the side door. The side door is the creative way to either buy a home that's listed in the multiple listing, and I'll give you an example, or to approach inventory in a way that gets you to not have to force yourself through the front door. Here is an example. I've told you time and time and time again that 1 out of 3 contracts written in our country fall through in the real estate market as it sits right now. Write a backup offer. You know, Preston gave a side door. Write an offer with a lease option in it. You know, work on your primary home. Rent it out. Sell it to the tenant. You know, there are multiple ways to create inventory. Those are just a couple. You have to find ways to bring inventory into the marketplace without going through the front door. So you have to use some creativity. And, you know, I'm getting ready to build some more houses, which I haven't done in a few years. And like duplexes, and with some of the current zonings, it's not an easy thing to do, but it's a great way to use my 401k or IRA or just cash to generate revenue. A lot of people do that.
Well, Well, Paul, you and the folks at Jameson are really good. You're problem solvers. I mean, yeah. And that's part of the deal. And, you know, sometimes it's the highest and best offer, but sometimes it's, okay, you know what your buyer's problems are, you know, and you talk to them, what are their goals? If you can find out what the seller's goals are too, mm-hmm. and, you know, what you've got to work with, and is there a creative way to solve everybody's problem?
Side door.
And that's how it's win-win, and that's what you guys at Jameson are really good at.
Yeah. You know, Preston, the one thing that we both focus on every day is understanding the market. Understanding the market gets you to win. It's not by going out with fake statistics to talk about how big you are. It's not about, you know, trying to take somebody's home from them at 40 cents on the dollar. It's not about paying for a listing appointment that you never intended to take to begin with. It's about doing and thinking creatively, communicating, and doing the hard work, period. End of day, always. If you do the work, then you earn the business you're expected to earn, and you grow and you get solutions for your client. If you give it your best, you get the best. And I got a great team, and so do you, and they work hard every day. Again, how do people reach you, Preston?
HomeInspectionCarolina.com or 704-542-6575.
And at Jameson, you can count on one thing. There are no footnotes, no disclaimers, no terms and conditions apply except hard work. We appreciate the business you all give us, and we look forward to helping you and others in this market to invest, to buy, sell, or to manage your family's rental property. Thanks for the opportunity to spend Saturday with you. I'm Paul Jameson, your host, and we'll see you next week. The Show Your Real Estate Today here on News Talk 1110 993 WBT. God bless.